Hi everyone, I'm Majid Bazarbash from the Monetary and Capital Markets Department of IMF. The COVID-19 pandemic has changed many aspects of our lives. We have limited activities like in-person shopping or engaging in social gathering. But some activities are essential and can't be avoided. A case in point is making payments. Making payments becomes especially a challenging thing to do in countries where they have limited access to digital banking. Consider Kevin and Christine, for example, from Africa. Kevin is a small business owner, and he deals with a lot of daily transactions on cash basis. Christine wants to order food, and both of them are reluctant to use cash because of the pandemic. Well, what can they do? They can use mobile money, which is what we are studying here. Our presentation is based on a joint work by colleagues from the Statistics and Monetary and Capital Markets Department of IMF. We have run a survey that finds and identifies the main policies and measures that countries have adopted to promote mobile money. We then analyze challenges and risks involved by implementing those policies. Our note is published online and could be found on IMF's website.
Thank you, Majid. I'm Hector Carcel Villanova, economist at the Statistics Department of the IMF. Mobile money has certain features that have made it an interesting way of increasing financial inclusion of the unbanked population, especially in low and middle-income countries. With mobile money, transactions can be made on the go. All that is needed is a rather inexpensive utility phone. This is facilitated by networks of mobile money agents, and storing value is as easy as charging a mobile money account. Mobile money services are provided by mobile network operators, or MNOs, such as Safaricom. With mobile money, there is no need to have a bank account to send or receive money. This feature is particularly important for those who are unbanked. Now, what have been the key advantages of mobile money during the pandemic? First, mobile money has a high market penetration, especially in low and middle income countries. Second, using mobile money allows minimal physical contact, which can reduce extremely the spread of the virus in comparison to paying by cash. And third, wide adoption of mobile money among the unbanked population helps to promote financial access during the pandemic. Facilitating payments to this segment of the population is very important, as they are likely the most affected by the economic impact. At the Statistics Department of the IMF, we compile the Financial Access Survey, the FAS, every year. The FAS is a unique source of supply-side annual data on access to and usage of financial services. The FAS currently tracks mobile money data for 78 countries. Our data indicates high levels of mobile money penetration in low-income and emerging economies, as shown in this chart, by the considerably larger number of mobile money accounts compared to the number of commercial bank accounts, especially in low-income countries. Now, our main contribution to this work has been to complement the FAST data by tracking policies promoting the use of mobile money across the globe in response to the pandemic. The Financial Access COVID-19 Policy Tracker is publicly available on the IMF Policy Measures Against COVID-19 website. The information in this tracker is taken from publicly available sources, inputs from other departments at the IMF, as well as feedback received from country authorities. The tracker is a living document and is updated on a regular basis. Our textual analysis of all the information gathered in this tracker reveals three main responses by country authorities worldwide promoting the use of mobile money during the COVID-19 pandemic. Cuts in transaction fees were announced by mobile money by regulators and so mobile money operators at the start of the pandemic, reducing mobile money costs and providing temporary relief to customers. This is why Christine would not need to worry about transaction fees when buying her food with a phone. Regulators typically impose limits on mobile money accounts. To encourage social distancing, some countries decided to increase these limits temporarily, benefiting small business owners. This way, Kevin could place larger orders for his business using mobile money. KYC, or Know Your Customer onboarding policy, consists on being able to identify customers or gathering enough information to detect possible risks. Easing KYC requirements during the pandemic was aimed at encouraging customers to make payments through mobile money services. Now let's look at some specific examples. In Kenya, charges on mobile money transactions of up to 1,000 Kenyan shillings, around 10 US dollars, were suspended until the end of the year. In Mozambique, daily transaction limits were doubled up to 250,000 metical, around 3,500 US dollars. And in Ghana, KYC onboarding requirements for mobile payments of up to 100 cedis, around 15 US dollars, were eased to promote the use of mobile money.
Thank you, Hector. So, as Hector mentioned, mobile money promoting policies help increase mobile money use in the economy. Transaction fee waiver is going to help Christine to pay for the pizza without worrying about the transaction fee. And increased transaction limits is going to help Kevin run his business more smoothly. Now let's take a step back and look at the potential challenges and risks involved by these policies. In particular, we focus on risks and challenges of a rapid increase in mobile money use in the economy by three main stakeholders: mobile money providers, the payment system, and mobile money users. Starting with mobile money providers, a reduction in fee income and an increase in transactions translates into pressure on profitability. For example, Safaricom, a large mobile network operator in Kenya who offers mobile money services, reported a loss of $52 million in the 3 months after mobile money measures were in place. Well, what's the solution? One way could be to raise revenues from other lines of business, for example, by increasing fees on voice and data, but this may not always be feasible. And in that case, a continued decline in profitability could jeopardize the mobile money business model. While Kevin and Christine enjoy making payments on mobile money, thanks to the new policies in place, it's the mobile money provider who has to make sure that these payments go on smoothly and seamlessly. That means that the mobile money provider should ensure to identify who's sending and who's receiving and record the transaction and execute it. More importantly, the mobile money provider should protect the funds against the risk of cyber attacks and ensure security and integrity of the platform. Flexible KYC or Know Your Customer policies are likely to increase the risk of jurisdictions to be non-compliant with respect to FATF standards. Now let's move on to see the big picture, the payment system, and imagine that the mobile money providers are large and systemically important. This is very likely because mobile money providers build on mobile network operators, which benefit from economies of scale. Becoming a systemic player in the payment system means that their failure is going to have severe consequences for the payment system. The second aspect is regulatory arbitrage. While it's important to support mobile money in time of the pandemic, but regulations should be careful not to create an unbalanced environment in favor of mobile money providers. In other words, they should avoid creating regulatory arbitrage for any payment system provider. Now let's look at the impact on mobile money users. An increase in the use of mobile money, while it's favorable, it requires the funds and rights of customers to be protected. We propose several ways that mobile money users could be protected in our note. I'll talk about three of them here. First, mobile money providers should segregate their own funds from trust accounts which back mobile money transactions. Second, mobile money providers should report to the payment system regulators on a regular basis, and their operations should be supervised regularly. Finally, the legal environment should be supportive of customers to make sure that their complaints are treated in a fair way. Today, we talked about policies and measures that countries around the world have adopted to take advantage of the mobile money opportunity during the pandemic. We also discussed potential challenges and risks. It's important for countries to take a holistic view when they are assessing these measures and make sure that they are sustainable. Thank you very much, and we'd be happy to take any questions.
Thank you.